we started to talk about, I just thought we'd continue with what I started to talk about last week, a week before last, yes? Does anyone remember what we were talking about? Now, the quiz. What were we talking about? It's not last week, because last week I didn't preach, it was the week before.
The man called Jesus.
What we were talking about him. What were we saying about the man called Jesus? No one remembers. We talked about, started at the beginning when we said that God made man in his own image. Remember? And we say that out of the dust of the earth. Hello, Sister Tasha. You're right. Out of the dust of the earth, man was made. And God gave him dominion over all the earth. And he said, be fruitful and multiply. Woo! Let's say that all together. Out of the dust of the earth, man was made. Oh, let's read it then. Woo! Don't get me excited. Genesis chapter 26. All together then, 1, 2, 3. Hallelujah. And have dominion. So we paraphrase and say what? Out of the dust of the earth, man was made. And God gave him dominion over the earth. And he said, be fruitful and multiply. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. You see, and then there were a few more things that happened. And then there was the serpent. And then there was a lie that was told. And then we didn't believe God's word. And then we ended up dead. And since then, God has been trying to get us back to the original man. We were living in our own shadow for so long that it became familiar with us. Remember when we say that God gave Adam the ability to name every animal that you see on earth. It was inside of him. That he didn't need to go to God and say, what shall I name this? But the incarnate presence, the power of God that dwelt in him, knew everything. He was full of power. He was full of knowledge. He was full of everything that you need. And he could name things without even blinking. He said, you are lion, you are cheetah, you are kudu, you are whatever it is that you can think of. Lizard, chameleon. And you know what? Well, when I think about that, when you look at something, the name really looks like it. I don't know whether you understand what I mean. If you look at a chameleon, you say, yes, it's a chameleon. Because it registers in you that this looks like a chameleon. Even if you didn't know what a chameleon was. Yes? You just look at the lion and you think, it is a lion. Because the incarnate power of the Lord was in him. He was able to do the things that God could do. He had the ability to understand. He had the ability to have wisdom. He had the ability to do what God could do and wanted. And then someone lied to him. And I say something that I was full of thought that I said, you know, in the Bible when you read, the only enemy or the only animal that's going to fight with us is the snake. But today when you look at the world, if I see a lion, I run. But God never said I was going to be afraid of a lion. But we are. Because of sin and everything else that happened, that we fell. And I said that we need to know that in the passage of time, God came to us and tried to tell us that this is the original man that I created. This is what I had in mind when I made you. This is what I wanted you to do. This is what I wanted you to have. This is how I wanted you to live. If you read the Bible, God says that I sent many prophets to you, many of them whom you killed. Oh yes, we do. We killed a lot of prophets. God sent his messengers. All they wanted to tell us was, return to the one who created you. This is the way that he wants you to live. This is the dominion that he has given to you over every animal, over every creeping thing, over everything. But we killed them. Amen. We killed them. Because there was something inside of us that was alive now. That didn't want anything to do with God. That's why when you tell someone the word today, they can get angry. Something rises up in them. And they think, how dare you say that to me? How dare you talk to me about Jesus? You know, some people are losing their jobs because of talking about Jesus. Because there arose in us something that fights against anything that stands for God. And I say, that's why you find it difficult to come to church. You wake up in the morning and you feel like, I don't want to go. We will be happy to see you when you make it. Sometimes we say church starts at 10, but no, I can't get up at 8. Okay then. It's a constant battle. It's a constant battle that you have to go through every Sunday. I have to go. We call you to come to Thursday. It's too much. You see, it's too much. I was in church Sunday. He wants me there Wednesday. He wants me Thursday. That's my whole week in church. There's something that fights God inside of you. Anytime I mention anything about meeting with you for church, something rises up in you and you say, how dare you tell me that? Because we became an enemy of God. We were separated from him. And we said, all we need to do is get reconnected to him. When we get reconnected to him, when we come to church, we can stand and we can lift up our hands and we can say, Father, I thank you for everything that you have done. I thank you that this morning I was able to come. I thank you because you have loved me. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever shall what? Should not what? But what? That's all God wants for you. He wants you. You see, I want to continue with this and give you a few thoughts. I want to give you a few thoughts about your life. I want to give you a few thoughts about life in general. I want you to have a few thoughts. When you live today, I want you to think and think about life at large and how you can live your life differently. And be the man, be the woman that God created you to be. I want you, when you finish in about 20 minutes, I want you to think and say, I am better than I am now. I am better than I've been. Because God did not create me to live a life like this. God gave me dominion over everything. And he told me to go and be fruitful and to multiply. But today, we've lost every ability to be fruitful. We've lost every ability to multiply. We are fighting day in and day out to scrape through was not the intention of God. See, I wanted to give you the first thought. Have you ever thought why Jesus came and he says, I came to give you life, and that in its fullness? Think about that for a minute. If you were alive, there was no need for Jesus to bring another life. Did you hear me? If you were alive, there was no need for Jesus to come and to say to you, I have come to give you life. And that he says, I have come to give you this life in abundance. Thought number one. Did you know that without Christ you are dead? Literally. Because if there was life in you without Jesus, then there was no need for him to give this statement and say, I came to give you life, and that in its fullness. Let's go to the book of Romans. You see, I want you to know that Jesus loves you. I want you to know that Jesus came to restore your life. I want you to know that Jesus is the only thing that can ever make you full. Without him, without your conscience really given to him, without your life completely surrendered to him, you will be a failure. The only success that could come into your life is when you put Jesus first and he becomes Lord. You see, this is very general, but most of us miss it. When Jesus is not the Lord and the Savior of my life is fruitless. My life is pointless. It has an appearance of goodness. It has all the appearance of everything that everyone else is looking for. But it's dead. Did you hear that? Let's examine this for a minute. Why does Jesus need to be Lord and then Savior? If I say someone is a Lord over you, what do you think? Yes, ma'am. Yes. Yes. What? A ruler, yes? What else? He's got power. He's a Lord. I said, Jesus has to be Lord over your life. What does that mean to you? He runs my life. He takes control. He is Lord. It's like, I want you to have a picture of, he is Lord. He covers me. Everything that I am is in him. Without him, there is no me. He is, and then he has to be the Savior. My God, you know, Jesus is the most beautiful thing that you could ever know. He is beautiful because he can do all these things. He can be Lord, and then he can save you. See, without him. Now, I want to talk to someone who knows that they are saved. Because when I get saved, do you know that some of the times we give Jesus parts of our lives? We give him, which is really what I've always said to people, and I say, you see, your timekeeping is very important to him. Give him your time. Because when you cannot keep time, when you cannot keep, it is like there is something that you're holding back. Why do you not get excited about Jesus? Why is everything about Jesus second hand? Does that mean that he's not Lord over you? If he was Lord, I would. You see, the first thing I think about, the everything I give is to the Lord. Because he is in control of my life. I have said, it is no longer I who lives, but Jesus who lives in me. That's how Paul writes them, he says, you know this mystery, brethren, that there is something that has happened to me. I no longer live. But you see, when we read the scripture we want to read, I think if we go to Romans chapter 8, you see, it says that there is therefore now no condemnation to those that are in Christ. Because there is such a thing as being in Christ. You could be in Christ. Most of us know about him. Most of us have heard about Christ. But we are not in him. He says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Did you know that those who are saved walk in two different ways? There are those who walk after the flesh, and then there are those who walk after the Spirit. Not me. That's what the Bible says. There is therefore no condemnation to them that are in Christ, who don't walk after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Did you know that for your life to go smoothly, you need to live in Christ and after His Spirit? Did you know that the struggles that you go through most of the time is because you are walking in the flesh as opposed to in the Spirit? Did you know that every time you operate in the flesh, you are operating in death as opposed to life in the Spirit? Let's read and continue. He says, for the law, there was an example. I really want to talk about this, because when you read these chapters, Paul begins to talk about the law of sin. And he gives an example and he says, the law of sin. There was in me the law of sin that operated. When I fell, go back many, many, many millions of years ago, when we fell, when we lied to God, and when we ate that fruit, and we discovered that we were naked, there was a law that was triggered, which was called the law of sin and death. Yes? The law of sin. I was like, this is so amazing. And he says, you know, husband and wife. He says, a wife is not supposed to leave their husband as long as they are alive. Are you watching that? For as long as your husband is alive, you can't leave them. But as soon as they die, if they die, you are allowed to go and marry another one. And remember, he is explaining the law of sin and death. And so I thought, what does this mean to me? If a wife has got a husband, they have to stay faithful to him as long as they are alive. Are you following that? As long, put yourself if you are a man, put yourself in the place of a wife and say, as long as my husband is alive, I have to live with them. That means that I am what? I am a servant to them. I am bound to them. I live for them, in a sense. Yes? Everything I do is legally. But then he goes on and he says, but when my husband dies, I am allowed to marry another. So let's go with a few thoughts. So does that mean that every time a person leaves and they are subjected to sin, or they do their things without Jesus, does that therefore mean that they are bound to that life? Does that therefore mean that when I do things in the flesh, I have become a servant to the flesh? And everything, therefore, that I do is ruled by and provided for by the flesh. So that in the end, I can only reap what the flesh sows. Oh my God. Just a few thoughts.
Let's read the Bible before I tell you the next thing I'm thinking of.
For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death.
Two laws that I live under. Law of the Spirit, law of the flesh, and sin.
For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh. And I said a few weeks ago, in order for me to regain the dominion that God had given me in the original man, when God created Adam and Eve, he gave them authority, he gave them dominion over all things. Now what happened is that I lost that dominion. I gave authority, as the scripture will explain in a bit, it says that for everything that you yield to, you become a servant to. Are you watching that? Adam and Eve yielded to the devil, and they were cheated, or they whatever happened to them, they gave into his word, and because they yielded to him, they became a servant. So all of a sudden, the tables were turned. Instead of them having dominion over the earth, the devil had dominion through them over the earth. Because this authority was given to man. And God says, you can rule over the earth. But man, in being clever, delegated the authority to the devil. And so we became servants to something that we yielded ourselves to. Watch that. He says, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sin. Oh, what I wanted to say was, because the original man failed, God could not just come in and do something else that's different to his word. God had to keep to his word because he had given man, the original man is the man that he gave dominion to. So, in doing this, sending Christ, Jesus, God had to demonstrate that he was taking the dominion back from the devil and putting it back on man. So, therefore, when I am without Christ, I have no dominion. Because Christ is the only person who can restore the original position.
Am I making any sense? Because I can see your faces are blank now. Come on, give me a smile. Go on. Just a little one. So, let's read on. He said that, verse 4, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. I like that. We could spend a lot of time talking about that. Then he talks about something that's really exciting. He says, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. God, I think that's so tremendous. You see, the thing is, he is speaking to you and me. He is speaking to those who say to Jesus, come into my life, save me. I acknowledge that you came to die for me, and I'm a sinner, and I am in need of forgiveness. But he says to us, to be carnally minded is death. There are two orders that operate on this earth. There's what we call the carnal mind, And then there is the spiritual mind. If you look at most of the translations, don't put the big S on that spirit. He is talking about a man who lives their life and they are aware that there is a spiritual realm. I'm just trying to break it down so that we can see where he's coming from. And he says, to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is what? So, what am I saying to you as a Christian? When we come here this morning, when we come to this service, and when we are thinking about our lives, what is your mindset based on? Do you think after the carnal mind? Do you think like the world thinks? Or do you think like Jesus thinks? There are two ways you can think. You can be carnally minded. He is not talking that you are living in sin. That's not what he's talking about. He says you have a mind that is very fleshy, fleshly, or whichever you can describe it. I don't know what word to use. He says your mind always operates in the flesh. Your mind thinks like you are a loser. Your mind thinks like everything never works out for me. That's how you think. Because see, when you've been battered, I want you to follow me closely. Can you imagine Adam being able to name all the animals, being able to do all those things with God, and one day he found himself without the fellowship of God? How does he feel? He had died. That describes it perfectly. He had died. The life that he was used to, the way that things used to work, no longer work. He was battered, I'm telling you. I can see him one day sat on the floor and he was thinking, what have I done? What is going to happen from now on? Is this the life that I have to live now? There is something that is missing from my life. There was something I used to have that I don't have anymore. Is this it? How many times have you felt like that? Sometimes you sit down and you think, is this all there is to life? Is this all? Oh, how long am I going to go on like this? Oh, is there any hope anywhere? Oh, are things ever going to get better? Oh, what's the point? Oh, Phil, there are so many questions that you begin to ask. That's the mind of the flesh. Flesh then tells you that you are a failure. Flesh tells you that you can't do it. Flesh tells you that, you see, you have to work in my. I shan't go there. Let me leave that one on its own. You see, when I think after the flesh and I am regulated by the flesh, it's hard. Life is hard. I mean, there are people, when you meet them, you know that, oh, I'm going to have it today. Because all they talk about is their problems. How they can't make it. How nothing works for them. How everyone doesn't like them. How everyone is racist. How this one doesn't like them. How work is boring. How this, they can't do anything. Because they operate in the flesh. But you see, the other bit, he says, read it and hear what he says. I've lost it. For to be carnally minded is death. You see what we are talking about? The things that you do, the things that you think. As Mom said, when you think about Adam, he was dead. So what does that mean? When you have no Christ, when you walk after the spirit, after the flesh, you have death operating in you. Does that make it any clearer? Is that right?
When I operate outside the parameters that God has given, or outside the provision that God has made available for me, I am operating in death. Because whenever I am carnally minded, and hear this, that my mind cannot appreciate anything that is spiritual. It cannot appreciate the love of Christ. It cannot appreciate that Jesus would come and die for me. When I don't do that, I am operating in death. Because my mind cannot comprehend it. Okay.
He says that in verse 7, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be.
You see, no matter how you wish to get better, I want you to listen to this very carefully. Because he says that, listen to what he says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, good intentions on their own are not enough. Did you hear that? Did you hear what I said? Because he says, my mind, when my mind is carnal, I become an enemy of God. Because my mind is not subject to God's laws. Translation. When I try to do things on my own, in my own powers and ability, I am operating outside God's law. And there is nothing that I can achieve. For my mind is an enemy of God. Neither is it subject to his laws. My God, do you see that?
And he continues and he says, so then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God.
And remember, he's not talking about those who are in the world. He's talking to us. When we walk in the flesh, we cannot please God. What is the other verse that the other scripture that tells that we can't please God? Mama, you know.
Well, how else can I not please God?
For without it is the what? For when I walk in the flesh, I'm walking without faith, and I cannot please God.
Exciting, this, I'm telling you. So let's end it here, and we'll pick it up next Sunday. Verse 9, it says, but you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be that the spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the spirit of Christ, is none of his. It gets better. It gets really better there. Doesn't it? It gets better. It says, if the spirit of God dwells in you, if indeed he does, because if he doesn't, you are none of Christ. But you see, what I wanted to tell you today as I conclude is that, you see, you have provision through Christ. He has come to give you.
My.
Can I read this one? 1 John chapter 5. Because this one is really... I can't find it in my Bible. I want maybe verse 3.
For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous.
Mm-hmm. Continue with it.
For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world.
Listen to that. Listen, read it again very slowly and loud enough.
For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith.
Mama!
Everything that is born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory. Oh, yes. I mean, there will be many people in this church today, as you listen to me, who are thinking, how am I going to make it? How am I going to get out of this fix that I find myself in? How are things going to change?
For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world.
My God.
And this is the victory that overcometh the world.
Even our faith. Even our faith. I don't know how else to put it. But you see, when you are born of God, when you are born of God, you can overcome the world. I want you to know that if you have Christ in you, you've got the ability to overcome the world. Because Christ dwells in you, you are full of overcoming power. You are full of His grace. You are full of the ingredients that make it possible to make it in this world. You are predisposed. You are predisposed to make it by virtue of that which dwells on the inside of you. Just by being there, you are already capable of overcoming anything and everything that is in the world. Because you no longer walk in this tirade of how I am, how are things going to work out? How do I do it without? How you are an overcomer by virtue of heaven living inside of you. Just by being you. You don't even have to do anything before you become an overcomer. Because you are born of God. For everything that is born of God overcomes the world. This is the power that overcomes the world. Even our faith. My. Did you know you can overcome the struggles that you go through? Because it's inside of you. It's in there already. You've got potential, brothers and sisters. You are predisposed. You are made into one. And he continues and he says, for I am an overcomer in all these things. Not by virtue of walking in the flesh, walking in the spirit, and knowing that I am born of God. For anything that is born out of the spirit has life. Anything that is born in the flesh has death. Let's rise off it. We'll pick that up next week and we'll have a few more thoughts. Just so we can help ourselves to begin thinking like overcomers, to begin walking like overcomers, knowing that I have everything that I need to overcome the earth, to overcome the world, to become better than I have been lately, to become better than I've ever been because of Christ who dwells in, He is inside of me. For if Christ be for you, who then can be against you? If Christ dwells in you, what should you be afraid of? Begin to operate in the realm of the Spirit, where you have authority and you have power and you can overcome anything. Because this is the power, that overcomes the world, even your faith. Let's just thank God this afternoon and say, Father, we thank you for your word. Because we have the overcoming ability inside of us. Because we are born.